دعوتك ربي ومن لي سواك فيا ربي حقق دعاء من دعاك دعوتك والقلب في فرحة يناجيك يا خالقي في علاك وأنت البصير وأنت العليم بحالي ونور الحجام ضياك رأيتك ربي في كل شيء فزاد اليقين بقلب رآك ففي الزرع في الضرع في الأنس بانت بدائع صنعك بعض نداك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا يا رب العالمين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ارزقنا علما نافعا يا سميع الدعاء يا مجيب يا مجيب. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salawat and salutation upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will start the halaqa of the sublime beauty of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is actually from the book called Ash-Shama'il Al-Muhammadiyyah by Imam Muhammad ibn Isa At-Tirmidhi rahimahullahu ta'ala, with the accompanying biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by Imam An-Nawawi at the end of this book, inshallah. So the book that we have here is actually this one. This is published by Darus Sunnah. They are based in Birmingham, alhamdulillah. If you want to go for online shopping, they can do that actually. Really beautifully done, mashallah. Because what I'm seeing here is that it is a classic collection. So they have, you know, the way that they print books to connect ourselves with the classical sources, that is something that they are aiming for, alhamdulillah. Also, I would like to mention the importance of this book to start. In Nottinghamshire, so far, alhamdulillah, there has been no lesson that was done actually. If there was done, alhamdulillah, but we are doing it in a way that actually we'll try our best to connect to the classical sources from the Salaf al-Salih, starting with the Sahaba radiallahu anhu majma'in, then tabi'in and atba'u tabi'in. Okay, so also I would like to mention that alhamdulillah that we've started it in the fourth calendar month, because there are people, unfortunately, due to the ignorance, what they do is that they welcome the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, especially those who are in favor of celebrating the birthday of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wal-iyadu billah. The virtuous months in Islam are Dhul Qa'da, Dhul Hajjah, Muharram, and Rajabu Mudar alladhi bayna Jamada wa Sha'ban, the month of Rajab. Okay, Shahrullah al-Muharram. So these are the 4 months. Okay, so month number 11, month number 12, month number 1 consecutively. Then you have month number 7, which is the month of Rajab. But to give ta'zeem or to give emphasis for the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, simply because Rasulullah ﷺ was born in the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, it is actually not part of al-Islam. That is something we need to pay attention to. Alhamdulillah that today we are on the 7th of Rabi' al-Thani. Tomorrow, rather, because the sun is set now, so we are on the 8th of Rabi' al-Thani. Because in Islam, you know that the with the night, actually the day starts with the sunset, as we know. Okay, so we are on the 8th of Rabi' al-Thani, alhamdulillah. With that in mind, we'll go through the biography of Imam Muhammad ibn Isa At-Tirmidhi rahimahullahu ta'ala. His name and lineage. He is Al-Imam Al-Hafidh, the expert authority, Abu Isa, Muhammad ibn Isa, ibn Sawrah, ibn Musa, ibn Al-Dhahaq, Al-Sulami, Adrir, Al-Bughi, At-Tirmidhi. It is also said he was Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Yazid ibn Sawrah ibn Sakan. He is also said to be Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Sawrah ibn Shaddad ibn Isa. His lineage. As-Sulami, referring to the tribe of Sulaym Musaghar from the clan Ghailan. As for Al-Bughi, it is a connection to the Bugh, a village from the villages of Tirmidh, of Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, attributed to him due to the fact that he died there. Ad-Darir or Adrir. There is a disagreement about whether he was born blind or with sight. There is a disagreement whether he was born blind or with sight. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala mentions that what is most correct is that he became blind in his old age after his traveling and his writing down of knowledge, rahmatullahi alayh. Tirmidhi is a famous affiliation. He has become known by and is a connection to the city of Tirmidh, the city in which he grew up. It is located on the northern banks of the river Jahun, Amudariya, in north of Iran, one could say, closer to Central Asia. Nowadays, even it could be part of Uzbekistan. As a matter of fact, it is nowadays. Regarding his birth, the historians, al-Muarrikhun rahimahumullah, said that historians are not clear about the exact year of his birth, placing it in the first decade of the 3rd century of Arabic calendar, or Islamic calendar. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala said that he was born near the year 210 after Hijrah, maybe even in year 209 after Hijrah, due to the fact that most believe he died in year 279 after Hijrah. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala said that he was 70 years old when he died. Regarding his background in knowledge and his journey for talab al-ilm, for seeking knowledge, Imam al-Tirmidhi grew up learning from the scholars of his own and the scholars of Khurasan, such as Ishaq ibn Rahaway and Muhammad ibn Amr al-Sawwaq. He traveled to Iraq and Hijaz, which is Makkah and Medina, and took from the ulama of those places. He also traveled to many other places in order to seek knowledge. Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala never traveled to Egypt or Ash-Sham. Rather, he narrated from these two places through a medium. He narrated from these two places through a medium. It is also widely believed that he never even entered Baghdad, the capital city of Iraq. If he had entered Baghdad, he would have taken from the great Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayh. However, it has not been established that he did travel to Baghdad. What further strengthens this point is that Khatib al-Baghdadi rahimahullah ta'ala never mentioned him in his book called Tarikh Baghdad. If you just want to know about the history of Baghdad by Khatib al-Baghdadi rahimahullah ta'ala, Tarikh Baghdad, Tarikh al-Baghdad, in it there is no mention of Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala's name. Okay. Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala spent much of his time traveling and taking knowledge from the ulama. He collected and authored books and did so well and benefited others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon him. Allahumma ameen. Regarding his teachers, his mashayikh, his asatida, Imam al-Tirmidhi traveled to many places and heard from many people. He also shared many teachers with Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, and among them a group who all the imams of the famous six books of hadith, Kutub al-Sitta, as we know, Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasai, Ibn Majah. Okay, these are the main books of hadith, Kutub al-Sitta. Okay, so famous six books of hadith narrated from, and they are, so Muhammad ibn Bashar or Bandar, Abu Musa Muhammad ibn Muthanna, Ziyad ibn Yahya al-Hassani, Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Azim al-Ambari, Al-Sa'id ibn al-Ash'aj, Abdullah ibn Sa'id al-Kandi, Abu Hafs, Amr ibn Ali al-Aflas, Ya'qub ibn Ibrahim al-Daruqi, Muhammad ibn Mu'ammar al-Qaisi al-Bahraini, Nasr ibn Ali al-Jahdami. He also reached many ulama who were before these scholars, the names that I mentioned earlier. Qutayba ibn Sa'id al-Madani, Ishaq ibn Rahaway, Ali ibn Hajar al-Maruzi, Abu Mus'ab Ahmad ibn Abu Bakr al-Zuhri al-Madani, Suwayd ibn Nasr ibn Suwayd al-Maruzi, Abdullah ibn Muawiyah al-Jahmi, Muhammad ibn Abdul Aziz Abu Ruzmah, Muhammad ibn Abdul Malik ibn Abu Shawarib, Ismail ibn Musa al-Farazi al-Suddi, Al-Farazi al-Suddi, Ibrahim ibn Abdullah ibn Hatim al-Harawi, and many other ulama, rahimahumullah ta'ala. Imam al-Tirmidhi greatly benefited from the major ulama who were the very pinnacle of memorization and understanding of hadith. Not only just memorization of the Quran, but they were also focusing on memorizing a hadith. in his time. However, his greatest influence and from whom he benefited the most was Al-Imam Al-Hafidh Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. He was the student of Imam Al-Bukhari and took knowledge of hadith and its understanding. He also met Imam Muslim ibn Hajjaj rahimahullah ta'ala and also learned from him. Okay. He also met Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayh, Imam Abu Dawud Sulaiman ibn al-Ash'ath al-Sijistani. Okay, the Sunan that he wrote, Sunan Abu Dawud. He also acquired knowledge of defects of hadith. Defects of hadith means the ahadith that are weak, so that they can be differentiated from the ahadith that are authentic. Defects of hadith. What are the criteria that make the ahadith defected? Okay. And narrators. Even in the chain of isnad, in the chain of narrators, you would see they, you know, it is those who practice a hadith, those who memorize a hadith, they memorize a hadith with the chain. So within the chain, if there is a person who has question mark on him, they also are being memorized by the learners. Imam At-Tirmidhi did the same thing. And other aspects of hadith from Imam Abdullah ibn Abdurrahman al-Darimi. Sunan al-Darimi that we know, one of the collectors of hadith, Shaykh al-Darimi rahmatullahi alayhi. Abu Zur'ah al-Razi rahmatullahi alayhi was also his teacher, as he has mentioned toward the end of his collection of hadith regarding his students now, students of Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam al-Tirmidhi became a distinguished alim or scholar who would benefit others through his knowledge and works. The people that narrated from Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, many. There were many. Some of them are mentioned in At-Tahdhib, Tadhkiratul Huffaz, and Siyar A'lam al-Nubala. These are the three books where the names of the people who have served the Islam through their contribution with the recordings of ahadith, with the recordings of the verses of the Quran. Memorization of the Quran. Among them, the students were Abu al-Abbas Muhammad ibn Abdan, Muhammad ibn Ahmad ibn Mahbub, al-Mahbubi al-Marwazi. Again, he's from Iran. Abu Sa'id al-Haytham ibn Kulayb al-Shashi, from Iran. Hamad, if not from Iran, from the central part of Asia. Hamad ibn Shakir ibn Sawiyah Nafasi. Then Abu Bakr Ahmad ibn Ismail ibn Amir al-Samarqandi. Samarkand, which is one of the central old Soviet Indian countries. Either I think it is Uzbekistan or Tajikistan. Tajikistan, highly likely that Samarkand is a city in one of those countries. Abu Hamid Ahmad ibn Abdullah ibn Dawood al-Marwazi al-Tajir. So al-Marwaz is another city in Iran. Al-Tajir means the trader, the businessman. Then you have Abu Ja'far ibn Sufyan ibn Nasr al-Nafasi, better known as Al-Amin. His standing in knowledge and the praise of the ulama for him. The ulama who were really amazed by his contribution to the Al-Islam. The ulama who are respected are all united in their admiration for him and praise for him. They bear witness to his elevated status in knowledge, memorization and competence. The Imam and scholar Abu Sa'id al-Sam'ani said about him, he is one of the Imams that were followed in the knowledge of al-Hadith. He authored the book Sahih al-Jami', a book on history and hidden defects in Hadith, like an expert scholar that he was. And he was used as a symbol of memory and precision, diqqa, okay, and hifdh. Hafidh al-Mazi rahimahullah ta'ala said about him, one of the well-known imams of memorization and someone who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefited the Muslims with, Imam al-Tirmidhi. Imam al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala said about him, the renowned memorizer, Hafidh Abu Isa al-Tirmidhi, writer of the collection of hadith, his reliability was unanimously acknowledged. Unanimously acknowledged. Then you have Mubarak ibn al-Asir. He said, one of the renowned ulama or the scholars and memorizers, he had a noble role in the field of what? Field of fiqh, jurisprudence. That has something to do with the rules and regulations of life of a Muslim. Ibn Hibban rahimahullah ta'ala said that he was from those that collected, authored, memorized and reviewed. Al-Hakim, the author of Al-Mustadrak, he said, I heard Malik ibn Ala said that After Bukhari rahmahullah ta'ala died, no one was left in Khurasan better than Abu Isa At-Tirmidhi in Hifd, meaning memorization, in Taqwa, meaning piety, and Az-Zuhud, ascetics. He wept until he became blind and remained so for the rest of his life. Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam Abu Isa At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi said that I was once on the road to Mecca, and I had written 2 volumes worth of narrations from a sheikh there that were with me. Subhanallah. While traveling to Mecca, he did 2 volumes of book written. It so happened that very same sheikh had passed by us, and so I asked the group of people about him. They said, he is so and so. So I eagerly went over to him, thinking I have the 2 volumes with me of his narrations. I inquired about those narrations, and he agreed to narrate them to me. I took out the 2 volumes, only to find the pages were empty. The sheikh started to read the narrations from his memory and looked at me and saw the white empty pages and said, "Are you not ashamed?" I said, "No," and told him what had transpired. "I have memorized all of what you have said," I informed him. So he said to me, "Read." So I read to him all of what he had read, but he did not believe me. He said, "You have memorized all of that before I came?" So I said, "Narrate something else to me." So he narrated another 40 narrations, 40 hadith to me from the rare narrations he knew. Then he said to me, "Read." So I read from the start to the finish and never made a mistake in a single letter. Single letter of hadith, meaning the narrators along with the narrations. So he said, "I have never seen the likes of you." Imam al-Bukhari said to At-Tirmidhi, rahmatullahi alayhi, "You have not benefited from me more than I have benefited from you." A teacher is praising his student. Imam al-Bukhari, main teacher of Imam At-Tirmidhi, he is praising his student At-Tirmidhi, rahmatullahi alayhi, saying that you have not benefited from me more than I have benefited from you. Imam At-Tirmidhi himself said that he showed his collection of hadith to the ulama of Al-Hijaz, Makkah and Medina, ulama of Iraq, then ulama of Khurasan, that is current day Iran. Okay, and they were all pleased with it. Whosoever has his book in his house is as if he has the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his house talking to him. So that is how he collected and gathered all the narrations. Okay, Abu Ismail, Shaykh al-Islam, said that the ahadith collection of Imam At-Tirmidhi is more beneficial than Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim, rahmatullah alayhi. One alim said that. Because the benefits of those books are only fully appreciated by those well-grounded in the knowledge of hadith. As for Imam At-Tirmidhi, then everyone is able to benefit from it. Regarding his works, okay, to this day they are reflected. Among them are Al-Jami', better known as Sunan At-Tirmidhi. Okay, Sahih Al-Jami' of Imam At-Tirmidhi, that is better known as Sunan At-Tirmidhi. Then Ash-Shama'il Al-Muhammadiyyah, the book that we will go through inshallah. Then we have Al-Ilal Al-Saghir. It is an appendix at the end of Jami', meaning Sunan At-Tirmidhi, collection of ahadith, and it is the book that follows it. Then you have Ilal Al-Kabir. Then you have Asma'ul Sahaba, the names of the Sahaba of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It begins with the names of the 10 companions promised in Jannah, Al-Asharatul Mubashirun Bil Jannah. Then it lists all the other Sahaba in alphabetical order in Arabic. Bitariqah Abjadiyyah. بِطَرِيقَةَ أَبْجَدِيَّةَ أَلِفْ بَا جِيمْ دَالْ. That is how they are done in Arabic language. Okay, by mentioning their names and then their titles. He has another book called At-Tariq, the history. The book has not yet seen the light of the day. It has been mentioned as part of his works. Then, رُبَعِيَّةَ الْحَدِيثِ. This book has been mentioned by the author of the book, هَدِيَّةَ الْعَارِفِينَ, as part of the works of Imam At-Tirmidhi. Then of course, Az-Zuhud by Imam Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani. He mentioned in his Tahdhib and said that it has not yet been found. Some of the works have not yet been found. Another work is Al-Asma' wal-Kuna. Okay, Hafidh ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani rahmatullahi alayhi mentions it in At-Tahdhib. كتاب في أثر الموقوفة Imam At-Tirmidhi mentioned it himself at the end of his hadith collection, which is Sunan At-Tirmidhi, at the very start of the appendix. His death, rahmatullahi alayhi, was an example of taqwa and devotion, to the point that he lost his sight at the end of his life and remained blind for many years, rahmatullahi alayhi. Many have mentioned that he died on Monday, the 13th of Rajab, year 279 after Hijrah. He died in the village of Bugh, where while others say that he died in the area that he was born, At-Tirmidh. There is no contradiction in this, as Bugh is in Tirmidh. Okay, Bugh area is in Tirmidh, in the central part of Asia. So whosoever said Bugh is being more precise, and whosoever said Tirmidh is simply being general, intending the same place. And this is something known and used a lot. Okay, so if I were to say, generally speaking, that someone died in Nottingham, and someone else is saying that he died in Radford, Radford is part of Nottingham. That's how it is. Okay, so Bugh was one of the municipalities of Tirmidh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon Imam At-Tirmidhi, for indeed he has left behind many beneficial works. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him greatly, along with the imams of the Muslims who preserved the ilm, the knowledge and sciences of this religion, and conveyed it as they heard it for those that would come after them. Allahumma ameen. With that in mind, brothers and sisters, we'll go through chapter 1 of Ash-Shama'il Al-Muhammadiyyah. Babu ma ja'a fi khalqi Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What has been narrated concerning the description of the physical appearance, khalq, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أخبرنا أبو رجاء قتيبة ابن سعيد عن مالك بن أنس عن ربيعة ابن أبي عبد الرحمن عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أنه سمعه يقول كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس بالطويل البائن ولا بالقصير ولا بالأبيض الأمهق ولا بالآدم ولا بالجعد القطط ولا بالسبط. بعثه الله تعالى على رأس 40 سنة فأقام بمكة 10 سنة وبالمدينة 10 سنين. وتوفاه الله تعالى على رأس 60 سنة وليس في رأسه ولحيته 20 شعرة بيضاء. Abu Raja Qutaybah ibn Sa'id informed us from Malik ibn Anas, from Rabi'ah ibn Abu Abdul Rahman, that he heard Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu saying that Anas bin Malik, by the way, he was khadim of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember that he was actually given by his mother to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From a very young age, he was there. So when it comes to narration of the hadith, Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala is one of the top five. First one is Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Then you have Aisha, Umm al-Mu'minin Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, bint Abi Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Then you have Abdullah ibn Umar, then you have Abdullah ibn Abbas, then you have Anas bin Malik, and there are other companions that goes. So Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that he heard Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was neither excessively tall nor short. In complexion, he was neither pale white nor very dark. So actually that would upset the black people right now. So in complexion he was neither pale white nor very dark. Black, neither
you can see someone like
your somewhere. Yeah, so Arabs are known to be brown anyway. Yeah, or this is skin color as well next to you.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. Like people like Yemen, like him.
Yeah, they are, alhamdulillah.
So if it's not,
but the thing is that I haven't got curly hair or same as you guys. I haven't got curly hair.
Yeah, but the thing is, yeah, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't have a curly hair, is it? He just have
no, you have slight curly.
Slight curly, yeah.
That means he's Yemenis.
Anyway, let's finish the hadith. Let's finish the hadith here. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was neither excessively tall nor short. In complexion, he was neither pale white nor very dark. Neither was his hair tightly curled, nor completely straight, but slightly wavy. When he reached the age of 40, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him an-nubuwwah, the prophethood. He stayed for 10 years in Mecca and in Medina for 10 years. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his soul upon the completion of 60 years. At that time, there were no more than 20 white hairs on his head and beard. No more than 20 white hairs on his head and beard. This hadith is recorded by Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayh.
What did that mean, Sheikh, please?
It means that he didn't have too much grey hair. As simple as it is.
What the hadith was saying here? More than 20 white hair on his head.
12.
Is it 12? Yeah, 12.
Did,
white hair.
60 years, no more than 20. Here, 20.
Is it 20?
Yes,
on his head and his beard.
Yeah, no more than 20.
In one of these, that mean of 100. Hundreds.
Okay, so this hadith is recorded by Imam al-Bukhari and his student Muslim ibn Hajjaj rahmatullahi alayhi, along with Imam At-Tirmidhi, who is also a student of Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi. So next hadith regarding the khalq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. حدثنا حميد بن مسعدة البصري قال حدثنا عبد الوهاب الثقفي عن حميد عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ربعة ليس بالطويل ولا بالقصير حسن الجسم وكان شعره ليس بجعد ولا سبط أسمر اللون إذا مشى يتكفأ. حميد بن مسعدة البصري رحمه الله تعالى narrated to us that عبد الوهاب الثقفي narrated to us from Humayd that Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu said Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was of a medium stature. He was neither excessively tall nor short, with handsome physique, hasan al-jism, handsome physique. His hair was neither tightly curled nor completely straight, but slightly wavy. He had a red-colored complexion, asmar alone. When he walked, he would incline forward. This hadith is recorded by Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam al-Nasa'i in his book Al-Kubra, Sunan al-Kubra, then Imam al-Tirmidhi, and he said this hadith is Hasan, Sahih, Gharib. Good chain, authentic chain, Gharib, which is strange. Next hadith, حدثنا محمد بن بشار يعني العبدي قال حدثنا محمد بن جعفر قال حدثنا شعبة عن أبي إسحاق قال سمعت البراء بن عازب رضي الله عنه يقول كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجلا مربوعا بعيد ما بين المنكبين عظيم الجمة إلى شحمة أذنيه عليه حلة حمراء ما رأيت شيئا قط أحسن منه. Muhammad ibn al-Bashar, ibn Bashar al-Abdi narrated to us that Muhammad ibn Ja'far narrated to us that Shu'ba narrated to us from Abu Ishaq that he heard Bara ibn Azib radiallahu ta'ala anhu saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man of medium stature, broad-shouldered, with luxuriant hair, jummah, reaching the lobes of his ears, wearing a red garment, meaning hullah. Never have I seen anything more beautiful, meaning ahsan, than him. This hadith recorded by Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, and An-Nasa'i. Next one, حدثنا محمود ابن غيلان قال حدثنا وكيع قال حدثنا سفيان عن أبي إسحاق عن البراء ابن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه قال ما رأيت من ذي لمة في حلة حمراء أحسن من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم له شعر يضرب منكبيه بعيد ما بين المنكبين لم يكن بالقصير ولا بالطويل. محمود بن غيلان narrated to us, وكيع narrated to us, سفيان الثوري رحمة الله عليه narrated to us from Abu Ishaq on the authority of براء ibn عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه that he said, never have I seen anyone with a lock of hair flowing below the ears, لمة, and wearing red garments, حلت حمراء, more handsome, meaning أحسن, than Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He had hair touching his shoulders and was broad-shouldered. He was neither excessively short nor tall. This is recorded by Imam Bukhari, Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Ibn Hajjaj, and Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahumullah. Next hadith from Muhammad ibn حدثنا محمد بن إسماعيل حدثنا محمد بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا أبو نعيم قال حدثنا المسعودي عن عثمان بن مسلم ابن هرمز عن نافع بن جبير بن مطعم عن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه قال لم يكن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالطويل ولا بالقصير شثن الكفين والقدمين ضخم الرأس ضخم الكراديس طويل المسربة إذا مشى تكفؤا كأنما ينحط من صبب لم أرى قبله ولا بعده مثله. Muhammad ibn Ismail narrated to us, Abu Naim narrated to us, Mas'udi narrated to us, from Uthman ibn Muslim ibn Hurmuz, from Nafi' ibn Jubair ibn Mut'im, on the authority of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he said, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, paternal cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, along with son-in-law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was neither excessively tall nor short. He had sturdy hands and feet. He had proportionally large head and limbs and a long thin line of hair stretching from his chest to his navel. When he walked, he leaned forward as if descending a slope. I have not seen anyone before him nor after him, one who was comparable, mithil to him. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this hadith, the quality is praiseworthy in a man as it denotes strength and courage, but is not praiseworthy for a woman. Regarding the sturdy hands and feet, this is the mention of Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi. This hadith, however, is recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi, Ibn Hibban, Al-Hakim, At-Tirmidhi, Al-Hakim. And Imam At-Tirmidhi said this hadith is Hasanun Sahih. Okay, authentic chain along with the good chain. Next one is from سفيان ابن وكيع حدثنا سفيان ابن وكيع قال حدثنا أبي عن المسعودي بهذا الإسناد نحوه بمعنى. سفيان ابن وكيع narrated to us, my father narrated to us from مسعودي the likes of this with this إسناد, with this chain of narration. Next hadith, it is quite long, however it would be quite beneficial inshallah. حدثنا أحمد بن عبدة الضبي البصري وعلي بن حجر وأبو جعفر محمد بن الحسين وهو ابن أبي حليمة والمعنى واحد. قالوا حدثنا عيسى بن يونس عن عمر بن عبد الله مولى غفرة قال حدثني إبراهيم بن محمد من ولد علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه قال كان علي رضي الله عنه إذا وصف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لم يكن رسول الله بالطويل الممغض ولا بالقصير المتردد كان ربعة من القوم لم يكن بالجعد القطط ولا بالسبط كان جعدا رجلا ولم يكن بالمطهم ولا بالمكلثم وكان في وجهه تدوير أبيض مشرب أدعج العينين أهدب الأشفار جليل المشاش والكتد أجرة ذو مسربة شأن الكفين والقدمين إذا مشى تقلع كأنما ينحط في صبب وإذا التفت معان بين كتفيه خاتم النبوة وهو خاتم النبيين أجود الناس صدرا وأصدق الناس لهجة وألينهم عريكة وأكرمهم عشرة من رآه بديهة هاباه ومن خالطه معرفة أحبه يقول ناعته لم أر قبله ولا بعده مثله. قال أبو عيسى سمعت أبا جعفر محمد بن الحسين يقول سمعت الأصمعي يقول في تفسير صفة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الممغط يعني الذاهب طولا وقال سمعت أعرابيا يقول في كلامه تمغط في نشابته أي مدها مدا شديدا والمتردد يعني الداخل بعضه في بعض قصرا وأما القطط فشديد الجعودة والرجل الذي في شعره حجونه أي تثن قليل وأما المطهم فالبادن كثير اللحم والمكلثم المدور الوجه والمشرب الذي في بياضه حمرة والأدعج الشديد سواد العين والأهدب الطويل الأشفار والكتد مجتمع الكتفين وهو الكاهل والمسربة هو الشعر الدقيق الذي كأنه قضيب من الصدر إلى السرة والشثن الغليط الأصابع من الكفين والقدمين والتقلع أن يمشي بقوة والصبب الحدود يقال إن حدرنا في صبوب وصبب وقوله جليل المشاش يريد رؤوس المناكب والعشرة الصحبة والعشير الصاحب والبديهة المفاجأة يقال بدهته بأمر أي فجأته. Subhanallah. In Arabic, even for me, it is tough to understand, but it breaks down. Even in Arabic language, those who were A'rabi, you would see them to be breaking down these words. Okay, because Abu Isa rahmatullahi alayhi mentions, or Abu Isa Tirmidhi mentions over here that Sami'tu Aba Ja'far ibn Muhammad. Then later on, he brings the quotation of those who were very good at Arabic language, they broke it down. Ahmad ibn Abdah al-Dabbi al-Basri narrated to us, as did Ali ibn Hujr and Abu Ja'far Muhammad ibn Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Halima, with different wordings but the same meaning. Isa ibn Yunus narrated to us from Umar ibn Abdullah, the servant of Ghufra. Ibrahim ibn Muhammad, one of the sons of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, narrated to me that when Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu described Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would say Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was neither extremely tall nor extremely short, but of a medium stature among people. His hair was neither tightly curled nor completely straight, but had a slight wave in it. He was not overweight, nor was his face so fleshy as to be completely round. Rather, it was only slightly round. Meaning, he did not have a fully round face nor a fully elongated face, but in between the two. He was fair-skinned, having a reddish tinge. He had jet black eyes, pupils, with long eyelashes. This is, we are talking about physical description of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had big bone joints and broad shoulders. Most of his body was hairless, though he had a long thin strip of hair extending from his chest to his navel. He had sturdily built hands and feet. When he walked, he moved briskly as if descending a slope. When he addressed a person, he turned his entire body towards that person. Meaning, he did not only turn his face towards the person he addressed, as this is considered impolite. This is considered rude, and sometimes it even denotes pride, meaning arrogance. The seal of the Nubuwwah, Khatam al-Nubuwwah, the seal of the prophethood, was situated between his shoulders. He was the seal of all the prophets, Khatam al-Nabiyyin. He was the most generous. He was the most faithful of the people in speech, the best of them in temperament, and the most sociable amongst them. If someone saw him unexpectedly, he was awestruck by him. And if someone came to know him, he loved him. Those who described him would say, I have never seen anyone before him nor after him. One who was comparable, meaning mithil, to him. This hadith is recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayh. Having said that, this hadith has a weak chain, although some of the wording has been established in other authentic narrations. Okay, next hadith is again from Sufyan ibn Waqi', who said that قال حدثنا جمعي ابن عمير ابن عبد الرحمن العجلي إملاء علينا من كتابه قال أخبرني رجل من بني تميم من ولد أبي هالة زوج خديجة يكنى أبا عبد الله عن ابن لأبي هالة عن الحسن بن علي رضي الله عنهما قال سألت خالي هند ابن أبي هالة. Even Hind can be a name for boys in Arabic. Remember that. Hind can be a name for boys. Okay, not necessarily for girls, but also for boys. Hind ibn Abi Hala, wa kana wassafa. Wassafa means the one who would describer. Okay. An hilyat an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ana ashtahi an yasif li minha shay'an ataallaq bih. Faqal kana an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fakhman mufakhama yatala'la wajhuhu tala'lu' al-qamari laylat al-badr, atwala min al-marbu' wa aqsara min al-mushaddab, 'azim al-hama, rajul ash-sha'r. إن انفرقت عقيقته فرقها وإلا فلا يجاوز شعره شحمة أذنه إذا هو وفره أزهر اللون واسع الجبين أزج الحواجب سوابغ في غير قرن بينهما عرق يدره الغضب أقنى العرنين له نور يعلوه يحسبه من لم يتأمله من لم يتأمله أشم كث اللحية سهل الخدين ضليع الفم مفلج الأسنان دقيق المسربة كأن عنقه جيد دمية في صفاء الفضة معتدل الخلق بادن متماسك سواء البطن والصدر عريض الصدر بعيد ما بين المنكبين ضخم الكراديس أنور المتجرد موصول ما بين اللبة والسرة بشعر يجري كالخط عار الثديين والبطن مما سوى ذلك أشعر الذراعين والمنكبين وأعالي الصدر طويل الزندين رحب الراحة شثن الكفين والقدمين سائل الأطراف أو قال شائل الأطراف خمصان الأخمصين مسيح القدمين ينبو عنهما الماء إذا زال زال قلعا يخطو تكفيا ويمشي هونا ذريع المشية إذا مشى كأنما ينحط من سبب وإذا التفت جميعا خافض الطرف نظره إلى الأرض أطول من نظره إلى السماء جل نظره الملاحظة يسوق أصحابه يبدر من لقي بالسلام. Sufyan ibn Waqi' narrated to us, Jumayr ibn Umayr ibn Abdul Rahman al-Ijli narrated to us, I was informed by a man from Banu Tamim, one of the children of Abu Hala, husband of Khadija, called Abu Abdullah from Abu Hala, al-Hasan ibn Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, who said, I inquired from my maternal uncle Hind ibn Abi Hala, son of Abi Hala radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Okay, about the noble features of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had often described the noble features of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in detail. Quite often he described them. I felt that I should hear from him personally some of the noble appearance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so that I could make his description a proof and testimony for myself. And also memorize them. And if possible, try to emulate and adopt them. So he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was majestic and esteemed. His face would shine with the radiance of the moon on the moonlit night. He was slightly taller than a man of medium height, yet shorter than someone extremely tall. His head was grand and impressive, with loosely curled hair. If his hair became parted naturally in the middle, he left it so. Otherwise, he did not habitually make an effort to part his hair in the middle. Okay, those who can do part the hair, he did not do so. It was natural. He just left it there. Otherwise, his hair, if hair could be parted easily, he would part it. Otherwise, his hair would not exceed his ear lobes. And he would let it grow plentiful and long, wafra. He had a radiantly fair complexion and a wide forehead. His eyebrows were long and perfectly arched without being connected, with a vein between them that used to throb when he became angry. His nose was prominent with a fine tip, slightly curved from the center and shown so that any casual observer would think that he had an elevated bridge, Shem. He was thickly bearded. Rasulullah's beard was thick, endowed with smooth cheeks, a moderately wide mouth, a gap between his two upper front teeth, and a long thin strip of hair extending from his chest to his navel. His neck was beautiful and thin, as if his neck were the neck of a statue shaped in pure silver. He was well proportioned in physique. His stomach and chest were perfectly aligned. He was wide-chested, broad-shouldered, endowed with large joints denoting strength and very shiny bare skin. He had a fine strand of hair like a thread running between the upper part of his chest and navel. His lower chest and stomach were hairless, while he had a lot of hair on his forearms, shoulders, and upper part of his chest. His forearms were long and his palms were wide. Sturdily built palms and feet, moderately long fingers and toes. The soles of his feet were slender and his feet were so smooth that water would bounce off them. When he walked, he lifted his legs with vigor, leaned slightly forward, and placed his feet softly on the ground. Not like softly on the ground. He walked at a brisk pace, not too fast, not too slow, taking long strides. When he walked, it seemed as if he was descending to a lower place. When he looked around, he turned completely. Okay, not just, no, he turned completely. When he would lower his gaze, and his gaze at the floor would be longer than his gaze at the sky. He would mostly gaze from the corner of his eyes. He would urge his Sahaba radiallahu anhu ajma'in to proceed ahead of him. And he would rush to offer the greeting of peace, meaning giving salam. Okay, he would rush to give salam to whosoever he met. This hadith, by the way, is recorded by Imam At-Tabarani rahmatullahi alayhi in his Al-Kabir, book called Al-Kabir, volume 22, pages 155 to 159. This hadith, however, has a weak chain. Having said that, some of the wording has been established in other authentic narrations. Okay. Next hadith, O servants of Allah, is from Abu Musa Muhammad ibn al-Muthanna. He said that حدثنا محمد بن جعفر قال حدثنا شعبة عن سماك بن حرب قال سمعت جابر بن سمرة يقول كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ضليع الفم أشكل العين منهوس العقيب قال شعبة قلت لسماك ما ضليع الفم قال عظيم الفم قلت ما أشكل العين قال طويل شق العين قلت ما منهوس العقيب قال قليل لحم العقب عقب. Abu Musa Muhammad ibn al-Muthanna narrated to us, Muhammad ibn Ja'far narrated to us, Shu'bah narrated to us from Simak ibn Harb, who said that he heard Jabir ibn Samurah radiallahu ta'ala anhu saying that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a wide mouth, reddishness in the whites of his eyes, and lean heels. Shu'bah said, I asked Simak, what is the meaning of dali' al-fam? To which he replied, a large mouth. I asked, what is the meaning of Ashkal al-Ain? To which he replied, wide eyes. I asked, what is the meaning of Manhus al-Aqib? Aqib. To which he replied, of little flesh on the heels. This hadith is recorded by Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi, student of Imam Bukhari, Imam al-Bukhari, as well as another student of Imam al-Bukhari, Imam At-Tirmidhi, the author of this book, rahmatullahi alayhi. Next one is حدثنا هناد ابن السري قال حدثنا عبثر ابن القاسم عن أشعث يعني ابن سوار عن أبي إسحاق عن جابر بن سمر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في ليلة إضحيان وعليه حلة حمراء فجعلت أنظر إليه وإلى القمر فلهو عندي أحسن من القمر فلهو عندي أحسن من القمر سبحان الله. Hanad ibn As-Sari narrated to us that Abthar ibn al-Qasim narrated to us from Ash'ath ibn Sawar, from Abu Ishaq, from Jabir ibn Samurah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who said, I once saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on a clear moonlit night, okay, wearing red clothing, hulla. I paused and gazed at him, meaning looked at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the moon, and found that in my estimation, he was more beautiful than the moon, sallallahu alayhi wasallam.
That means red is part of one of his best color.
It was, sallallahu alayhi wasallam.
But some people said red is not good to wear. That is what I was hearing. Is that true?
One way to look at it, maybe the case actually. But
that is what I was
saying. I wouldn't say that red, because along the red color you have many other colors that you can derive from, not necessarily like pure red. I'm talking about, for example, I wear a jubba that is of this dough color that you have. Okay, you could say that it is He could say that, yes.
Do you have a hadith that mentions it's not allowed to wear a red color?
I don't know. It is better to search for it. It is better to search for it. You can search for it in Islam QA if you want to search for it.
Yellow, it's not good to wear yellow scientifically because it gives cancer.
Okay, if it is the harmfulness of the...
When you have yellow, cancer.
Okay, subhanAllah. Of course, we are not allowed to wear silk or gold anyway because it would literally, you know, make you weak.
Yes.
Okay, so this hadith that I just read from Jabir ibn Samurah radiallahu ta'ala anhu is recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi in the chain of is Ash'ath ibn Sawar. Now in this hadith, there is someone called Ash'ath ibn Sawar who is weak, although the similitude of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's face with the moon and that he was more beautiful than the moon has other supporting narrations which will be mentioned later in this book inshallah. Next hadith is حدثنا سفيان بن وكيع قال حدثنا حميد بن عبد الرحمن الرؤاسي عن زهير عن أبي إسحاق قال سأل رجل البراء ابن عازب رضي الله عنه أكان وجه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مثل السيف أكان وجه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مثل السيف قال لا بل مثل القمر. البراء بن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه said that لا بل مثل القبر. سفيان بن وكيع narrated to us حميد بن عبد الرحمن الرواسي narrated to us from زهير from أبو إسحاق who said a man asked براء بن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه was the face of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم shining like a sword. Then البراء بن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنه replied no it was rather like the moon. This hadith is recorded by Imam At-Tirmidhi. The chain has Sufyan ibn Waqi' who is weak. However, Imam Al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi has narrated this same hadith with different chain, which is authentic. Next one, حدثنا أبو داود المصاحفي سليمان ابن سلم قال حدثنا النضر بن شميل عن صالح بن أبي الأخضر عن ابن شهاب عن أبي سلمة عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أبيض كأنما صيغ من فضة رجل الشعر رجل الشعر. أبو داود المصاحفي سليمان بن سلم narrated to us Nadr ibn Shumail narrated to us from Salih ibn Abu al-Akhdar from Ibn Shihab from Abu Salama from Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu that he said Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was fair complexioned as if his body was fashioned and molded from silver with loosely curled hair. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith is regarding this hadith, the Imam al-Tirmidhi mentions that this chain has Salih ibn Salih ibn al-Akhdar, about whom Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani mentions that he is weak but can be used with supporting evidence. It is mentioned in Taqrib al-Tahdhib, volume 2, page 271. Next one is from Qutayba ibn Sa'id, who said, أخبرني الليث ibn Sa'ad عن أبي الزبير عن جابر ibn Abdullah رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال عرض علي الأنبياء فإذا موسى عليه السلام ضرب من الرجال كأنه من رجال شنوءة من رجال شنوءة ورأيت عيسى بن مريم عليه السلام فإذا أقرب من رأيت به شبها عروة بن مسعود ورأيت إبراهيم عليه السلام فإذا أقرب من رأيت به شبها صاحبكم يعني نفسه ورأيت جبريل عليه السلام فإذا أقرب من رأيت به شبها دحية. Qutaybah ibn Sa'id narrated to us, Al-Layth ibn Sa'id informed me from Abu Zubayr, from Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, that Rasulullah said that the prophets were presented to me. And there was Musa alayhi salam, the specimen of men of distinction, and his build and height were medium, as if he was from the tribe of Shanu'a. I also saw Isa ibn Maryam, Isa son of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam. And the nearest I have seen in resemble to him is Urwa ibn Mas'ud. I also saw Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And the nearest I have seen in resembled to him is your companion. Okay, namely himself, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. I also saw Jibreel alayhi salam, archangel, leader of all the angels. and nearest I have seen in resemblance to him is Dihya, Dihyat al-Kalbi, another Sahabi. This hadith is recorded by Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi in his Sahih. Then Imam At-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi in his Al-Jami', okay, Sunan al-Tirmidhi, known as Sunan al-Tirmidhi, and Imam Ahmad rahmatullahi alayhi mentioned it in his Musnad, volume 3, page 334. Next one is حدثنا سفيان ابن وكيع ومحمد ابن بشار المعنى واحد قال أخبرنا يزيد بن هارون عن سعيد الجريري قال سمعت أبا الطفيل يقول رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وما بقي على وجه الأرض أحد رآه غيري قلت صفه لي قال كأن كان أبيض مليحا مقصدا. سفيان ابن وكيع narrated to us, as did Muhammad ibn Bashar, the meaning is one and the same, saying that Yazid ibn Harun informed us that Sa'id al-Jurayri said, I heard Abu Tufail radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Abu Tufail radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the last Sahabi to die in year 110 after Hijrah, if my memory serves me correctly, radiallahu anhu. He said that there is no one left on the face of the earth besides me who has seen Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I said, describe him for me. Sifhuli. He said, he had a fair complexion which was slightly reddish of medium sized. This hadith is recorded by Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi in his Sahih and Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi in his Sunan. Next hadith is حدثنا عبد الله ابن عبد الرحمن قال حدثنا إبراهيم ابن المنذر الحزامي قال حدثنا عبد العزيز ابن أبي ثابت الزهري قال حدثنا إسماعيل ابن إبراهيم ابن أخي موسى ابن عقبة عن موسى ابن عقبة عن كريب عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفلج ثنيتين إذا تكلم رؤيا كالنور يخرج من بين ثناياه. Abdullah ibn Abdul Rahman narrated to us. Ibrahim ibn Mundhir al-Hizami narrated to us. Abdul Aziz ibn Abi Thabit al-Zuhri narrated to us. Ismail ibn Ibrahim, the nephew of Musa ibn Uqba, narrated to me from Musa ibn Uqba, from Quraib, that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's two upper front teeth had a gap between them. When he spoke, it was like light emerging from his two front teeth. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is recorded by Imam al-Tabarani rahmatullah alayhi in al-Kabir. Okay. Hadith number 12181. And in al-Awsat. Okay. Hadith number 771. Chain has a narrator whose narrations are rejected. Bear that in mind, please. Okay. Chain has narrators. This chain that is mentioned, there is a narrator whose narrations are rejected, but it is not mentioned who. Okay, inshallah, in the next halaqa we'll go through Babu Maja'a fi Khatam al-Nubuwa, what has been narrated concerning the seal of the prophethood, inshallah.
I know we are ahead.
Yes.
The seal of the prophethood. I always want to know what is the seal of the prophethood.
First, we're sabran jameela, that is what I will say. That have patience, that is beautiful patience. Okay. This is in Surah Al-Ma'arij, you will see that inshallah. Okay. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all our efforts and accept all the good things that we are doing for. We'll come to that inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept it, and also the time that we're spending in the halaqat, so that it can be in the mizan of hasanat. Allahumma ameen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to follow Muhammad, to give us tawfiq to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as best as we can. Allahumma ameen. هذا ما عندي والعلم عند الله عليه توكلت وإليه أنيب إن أصبت فمن الله وحده وإن أخطأت فمن نفسي والشيطان فالله ورسوله بريئان وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.